The Dharma, incomparably profound and exquisite, is rarely met with even in hundreds of thousands of millions of kalpas. We now can see it, hear it, accept and hold it. May we realize the true mind of the Tathagata. Today is day 4 of this 7-day sesshin. The days are flying by rather rapidly, which says something about the concentration people are giving to the practice here during this sesshin. We're in April 2018 here at Mountain Gate in northern New Mexico. And again, the temperature is going up and down and up and down. This morning, 27 degrees. Now it's almost 60. It's 1 degree short of 60 degrees. And you never know what's going to happen around here. Keeps us hopping. And that is the nature of life, actually. But we try to freeze it. We try to keep it the way we want it, and we get disturbed in various different ways if it doesn't go the way we want it to. We get anxious, we get angry, we get frustrated. And yet, if we are able to allow ourselves to simply be, truly be, in each moment, then it's very different. It's a stress-free way of living, at the least, and it's a profoundly rewarding and intimate and fulfilling and rich and vibrant way to live. And the Buddha taught how to open to that when he taught the Eightfold Noble Path, and we've been talking the last several days about the first step on that Eightfold Path, which is right view. Seeing things accurately, not through the lens of our filters. I'd like to share again something from Mark Epstein's brand new book, Advice Not Given, The Guide to Getting Over Yourself. It's published this year, actually, 2018. Mark Epstein is a psychiatrist and a long-time Buddhist practitioner. It seems rather in concentrated measure. He speaks of his first teachers being Joseph Goldstein and Jack Kornfield, and these are Vipassana teachers in the Theravadin tradition, having trained in Southeast Asia, which is the seat of Theravadin Buddhism. Theravada Buddhism and Mahayana Buddhism are two different flavors of Buddhism as it developed. It's considered that Theravada Buddhism is among the first teachings of the Buddha soon after he had his great awakening, and that Mahayana, or the greater vehicle, meaning the path to liberation for not only ourselves, but we do it for the benefit of all beings. And ultimately the idea is to do whatever is possible to free everyone and everything. Theravada means the way of the elders, and it's sometimes pejoratively known as the Hinayana, or the single vehicle, meaning it's for me alone. But actually, if you look more closely at it, it doesn't really have that view necessarily. So I'm going to share first something that we shared yesterday, and it's really important. It's the basis of the practice of the right view. We live primarily in a disembodied mental universe, interrupted periodically these days by a need to check our phones to see if we have any messages. As in touch as we might want to be with others, we're very practiced at being at slight removed from ourselves. But if we try to counter these habitual tendencies, the mind's ability to drop its defensive and dissociated posture can be a real surprise. It's amazing how rich life can be when we allow ourselves to live it. what happens? We know by now from various stage shows and just from our own experience that life is full of conditioned events. Conditioned essentially meaning that when something happens of import to us, we gain ideas about it. We format an assumption, particularly assumption about who we are. We're likable or we're not. We're acceptable or we're not. We're abandoned or we're not. It can go on. And it depends entirely on our conclusions based on our experiences. And some experiences for some people in life can be pretty dreadful. And it's no wonder that we want to dissociate from this present moment, because who wants to feel that pain and anguish? If it's of that level, we want to consult a trauma therapist and work with somebody in an ongoing manner to help us navigate through the traumatic experiences we have had that have really influenced our perceptions in really major ways. Our practice on the cushion involves gradually bringing ourselves more and more to the present moment in everything, every moment, not just on the cushion. To that end, our Susokan practice, the practice of the extended out-breath, is invaluable for this, because as we extend that out-breath beyond where we would ordinarily breathe back in, we have to let go of ideas and assumptions, of thoughts, of images. And the more we do that on a regular basis, we are training ourselves not to be caught in our ideas and our assumptions, not to skim above life, but to live it more and more completely. And in the process, we will be coming up with all kinds of stuff. We'll begin to see, if we persist, where we are caught, how we do misunderstand situations based on our assumptions about them. And right view is about seeing things just as they are. And to that end, I'd like to share that something of a talk by Ajahn Sumedho, who is a Theravadin teacher, a Westerner. Let's see what his biography says about him. This is from a book called Seeing the Way, which basically is about right view. Ajahn Sumedho, whose birth name was Robert Jackson, was born in Seattle, Washington in 1934. On graduating from university, he joined the U.S. Navy as a medical officer and served in the Korean War. Returning to academic life, he took an M.A. in South Asian Studies from the University of California, Berkeley, in 1963. And after a short spell working for the Red Cross, he went out to the Far East and spent 2 years teaching English with the Peace Corps in Borneo. His growing interest in Buddhism took him in 1966 to Thailand, where he sought to enter monastic life. He became a novice in Nongkhai and a bhikkhu, which is a fully ordained monk. 1 year later, in 1967, with Chao Kun, and I will not be able to pronounce his last name, it's about a mile long, and the Thai language is as a unique quality that, or written language I should say, that if you have an R at the beginning, an R at the middle, and an R towards the end of a word, they're all pronounced differently. I did get 5 months of intensive Thai language training when my husband was doing his 10-month full-time course of Thai language training before we went to live in Chiang Mai, Thailand. But I know the thing about the written language because he had gotten his advanced in his own language training to be able to read newspapers in Thai. Mine was a little short of that. Ended up being able to have polite conversation with people, but certainly not to read newspapers. The Thai language is really quite complex, in addition to the fact that it's tonal. And the tones really make a difference. In fact, that's how they tell dirty jokes, by saying a word with a certain tone where it would ordinarily mean, for example, water buffalo. And if you say it in the wrong tone, it means something very different. So he became a fully ordained monk, and soon after his ordination, he was taken to meet Ajahn Chah, who was a very famous and very highly regarded Theravadan teacher in the forest tradition, with whom he stayed and trained for 10 years, following a Tudong pilgrimage. And if you remember from earlier Taisho in this session, Tudong is a wandering monk practice, where you simply wander with the robes you have on you and your begging bowl, your barefoot as well, often. At least when you're begging for food, you're barefoot. And you trust that you'll be supported. And in Thailand, you most likely will be. Following a Tudong pilgrimage in India in 1974, he helped establish Wat Pa Nanachat and became its abbot. In 1977, Ajahn Chah was invited by the English Sangha Trust to visit Britain, and he brought Ajahn Sumedho with him. And seeing the interest there left him in London at the Hampstead Vihara in charge of a small group of bhikkhus. In 1979, the monks were able to move to Sussex, which marked the beginning of Chitthurst Buddhist Monastery. And so it goes. So that's enough about him. Let's read a little bit of this talk. It says, the following teaching is taken from the first two talks given by Venerable Ajahn Sumedho to the monastic community of Amaravati during the winter retreat of 1988. Today is the full moon of January and the beginning of our winter retreat. We can have an all-night meditation sitting tonight in commemoration to commemorate the auspiciousness of the occasion. It's very fortunate to have an opportunity such as this to devote ourselves for 2 months to one pointed reflection on Dhamma. And Dhamma is the Pali way of saying Dharma, which is Sanskrit. The teaching of the Buddha is the understanding of the way things are. The way things are. The way things are. Not the way things we are according to our interpretation of them, but the way things are. We have various sense organs, eyes, ears, nose, tongue, body, and mind. And there are perceptions that come to these sense organs. And our brain interprets them. But if that were all, then that's the pure view. But what happens is we have a sort of a secondary interpretation of it. You hear a trilling outside in the springtime, bird song. And then you go, sounds like a robin. I'm glad it's not one of those yorokas which just squawk. And on it goes. And we find ourselves living in a story instead of the reality of the moment. When we train ourselves to live in the reality of the moment, it's quite different. We're not skipping above life. We're living it. And it is full and rich and rewarding. Even in the negative times. Even in the difficult times. And that's one of the amazing things about it. The teaching of the Buddha is the understanding of the way things are, being able to look, to be awake. It means developing attentiveness, brightness, and wisdom, developing the Eightfold Path, which we call bhavana. Bhavana means development. There is the metta bhavana, which is the practice of loving kindness. Now, when we're reflecting on things as they are, we're seeing rather than interpreting through the veil of self-view. It's this veil of self-view that causes us all kinds of misunderstandings, conflicts, challenges, difficulties. And so the more we can see things just as they are, instead of through these filters of conditioning, the more we will be at peace, even in difficult circumstances. The big obstacle all of us have to face is this insidious belief in the I am attachment to self-view. It's so ingrained in us that we're like fish in the water. Water is so much part of the fish's life that it doesn't notice it. The sensory world we've been swimming in since our birth is like that for us. And if we don't take time to observe it for what it really is, then we'll die without getting out of the water. Mark Epstein speaks of some experiences that his wife has had. Apparently his wife is she's a graduate of Rhode Island School of Design, and she's a sculptor. And he's always been impressed by how when she comes out of her studio after simply being absorbed in her art, in the creation, how clear she is. Of course, that's a certain level of awareness, and it's valuable. We want to take it deeper than that in the Zendo here, and open to our innate wisdom. But he talks about a couple of experiences she's had, one in which she had been best friends with and roommates with another woman at Rhode Island School of Design. And they had roomed together, actually, when they were both living in Boston after school. And then she married, she moved to New York. Epstein's wife moved to New York. But they stayed in contact. And when the roommate was in her 30s, she suddenly developed an extremely rare and virulent form of cancer. And Arlene Epstein went down to visit her as frequently as possible and to support her in this illness, of which she eventually died. And Arlene was quite distressed by the fact that her good friend, perhaps even best friend, they were almost like sisters, was dying at a young age of this extremely aggressive cancer, and it was really getting to her. And she mentioned it to Joseph Goldstein, who happened to be visiting. Joseph Goldstein is one of the Vipassana teachers, one of the Theravadan teachers, and she wasn't practicing at the time. I don't know if she ever started Zen practice, Buddhist practice, but she was certainly open to Buddhism. And he said something to her about, that's just the way it is. Everyone dies. And it may have seemed rather abrupt and intense and even perhaps aggressive what he said to her. It's hard to know because we weren't there, but her husband says that it really was a very kindly expression, and that it wasn't aggressive, and it did its work. It shook her up, and she suddenly realized she was going to die too. A And she suddenly realized as well that she wasn't just being sad and upset about her friend dying. She was making it into a big story. And that's what we do. We make things into a big story. And we get all caught in that big story. And it's a recipe for pain and suffering. So how do we get out of this pain and suffering? Well, we have this wonderful tool, as you've already heard so many times, called Susokan in Japanese, and we call it the extended out breath here, and it gradually brings us through every breath letting go to a place of bare attention, we might call it, radical acceptance, we could call it as well, where we're not gripped around the neck by circumstances. And also, another aspect of it is that we begin to see where we're caught in delusion. And part of that, seeing where we're caught in delusion, is seeing through that aspect of delusion and into clarity. And with that, normally, if we see deeply enough, that whatever that particular aspect of delusion that we've seen through is seen clearly as being false and basically discarded. I mean, why do we want to believe in something false? And gradually our view becomes clarified, and gradually we are living in the moment simply as the moment is, without this overlay of conditioning. As this continues, we become more and more clear, and eventually, if we persist long enough, we open deeply enough and broadly enough into what has been termed awakening or satori. And of course, as you've heard so many times before, that is not the end, it's a beginning, as Kappa Roshi used to say, because now we can see where we really need to work. And not only that, hopefully we're motivated to continue deepening that and broadening that. And here we hold up Hakuin, the great Zen master Hakuin from the 18th century in Japan, who completely, single-handedly changed the course of Rinzai Zen and reinvigorated it to the even to the point where we can practice it today, who had, by his own admission, 19 major Kensho experiences, that is, awakening experiences, and countless minor ones. 19, not one, not even two, 19. And it wasn't really until the final one that he felt truly free. We can do this too. It just takes perseverance, intention, a willingness to walk into whatever is there in this moment, seemingly feeling it, and continuing to extend that out breath, not turning our backs on anything, but willingly walking in. It takes courage to do this, and it means we're going to be confronted by anything we've buried inside ourselves. And this is where the courage comes to play. Who wants to feel the different feelings that we've shut down because they were so uncomfortable or because we didn't know what to do with them? We may discover we've got a ton of rage in ourselves. And who wants to be known as somebody that's full of rage? It's not a beautiful picture, is it? And yet, if we're to become free of it, we have to walk right into the energy of the sensations in the body that we would term rage, or anguish, or sadness, or frustration. It doesn't matter what it is. When we learn how to tune in to the felt sense and allow ourselves to stay present with that felt sense until it shifts or dissolves, we're on our way to opening to that right view. It's worth it. We have to persist. This is not an occasional practice if you want to get to be truly free. But it will be worth it if you do persist. And I thank you for listening now. We'll stop now and recite the four vows.